думаю, що всі вміють читати, але все ж таки зараз в нас буде представник VS Engineering Віктор Дерягін, і ми, мабуть, вивчимо, як користуватися GraphQL в Elixir. Зустрічайте!
Наш досвід.
Можеш
ближче? Should I use English? Should I use English?
As you want.
Okay, so I prepared in English, so might as well. I work for Wise Engineering, which is a company here in Toronto, and I work on a project where we use GraphQL. Which is an alternative way of building web APIs, alternative to REST, which everyone is familiar with, I assume. It's around for a couple of years now, started by Facebook in 2012 and public release in 2014. And the main difference from REST is that we got only a single endpoint, and the queries in the payload of the request with the sample payload to that endpoint, and the shape of response that you get back correspond to the shape of query, so you know what you're gonna get back immediately. And the main advantage for the Facebook, at least initially, was that it's very convenient to use on clients, of which they have a lot and a lot of versions, like mobile and web mostly. Your client sends requests whatever data it needs, and it receives exactly what it requested, like no more, no less. Which is also a good thing for web performance, because you don't have to like compress and parse all the bytes that you don't need on the client. Yes. Most useful way of thinking about GraphQL that I find is that it's types and relationships between those types. You got a static schema which is defined on the server, generally implementation for every popular programming language. And that schema consists of various fields which are more or less strictly typed. We'll talk about that later. Bunch of scalar types that are built in, and you can find your own. There are lists, you can find object, which is something like a struct in Elixir, which collection of fields. There are enums for enumerated values and unions for alternative representation of like a single value. You can issue queries, mutations, and there is a new thing, subscription, which like we personally don't use that, but it's potentially useful. First, you do for read-only stuff. Mutations is to change the state on the server, something like response to the get request and post put in REST convention. And subscriptions, you can send a query and you get like a channel which is used to push some changes to you, whatever channel you subscribe to. So, that's like the minimum introduction into, you know. Yes, but I skipped that one. That's an example of how it works. That's on the left there's query, and on the right there's response that you get. You can see the shapes of them resemble each other. Like one of the things to note is that nodes is an array in the response, and it contains object with created that key which was requested here. And the way it knows that it's an array and not a single object is according to how it was defined in the schema originally. about experience with it specifically. This very good introduction. If you're not familiar with Garfield the Dog, there's specification, like a draft of specification. It's not like in complete state yet. There was even a talk on Elixir Club, the previous Elixir Club. Slides online, you can find them easily. And more specific to Elixir, there's a book about the library, Absent, which we use for implementing our GraphQL API, and it's written by the authors of the library itself, so it should be good.
I don't see that.
Yes, the project that we work on is Teachers to Teachers, which is marketplace for educators. It's been around for a while now, like over a decade. Most of teachers in the United States are members there. We have more than 5 million of active users, millions of products that are on sale, and like around 60 engineers working on the project. Not all of them directly involved with GraphQL, but
yeah.
But the products that are sold, all kinds of education related stuff. Like it can be like lesson plans, it can be free curricula, it can be some various activities in classroom that teacher wants to
do.
So infrastructure is quite big. That diagram is somewhat outdated, but it's basically you have a bunch of PHP services, some Elixir, some Node, some more PHP, and a whole bunch of load balancers and data stores. It all runs on AWS. That chart should be updated by now. It did not get any simpler, I can assure you. Well, like more services there now.
And
one of the things that we have is Graph API. That is like a subset of the schema in graphical presentation. Handle about 200 requests per second, which is not a lot, but like different kinds of requests. Some are quite a bit difficult. That's where we perform most of the new feature implementation. Quickly about the stack that we use. We use Elixir, Phoenix. We don't use much of Phoenix, just mostly router and some methods here and there. Most like important part that developers interact with the most is Absent, which is GraphQL implementation for Elixir. And we got lots of data stores, like the mostly MySQL, and those are also we're using through Acto. On client, we use React with Apollo client, which is like both on a browser and iOS, and Relax for storing state. Yeah, there is another popular library for client-side GraphQL, which is Relay. Maybe if you may have heard of it, it's promoted by Facebook quite a bit. I'm not exactly sure why we chose Apollo and not that, but the differences, main difference is that Relay is much more opinionated. It imposes some quite strict limitations on the how schema gonna look like. And Apollo allows you to deal with whatever schema you got. It doesn't have to be, it just might be used with it. Been in development for around 2 years, slightly less than that. And it's been somewhat, like moderately successful. We are generally happy with how it runs, but there are some challenges, like a lot of challenges. And yes, I'm going to
talk about that. One of the really great features of GraphQL is
that schema you got on the server is can be easily introspected from client. You can just send a query. Everything has like metadata, like names and types, and it returns you like a piece of JSON, which is a full description of your schema. And this is a screenshot from the tool. It's called Graphical, which you might have heard of. And when you write in queries here, it provides you autocomplete and documentation that's like inline and error checking, and it's generally very convenient. There are also various extensions to the editors. If you write any client code, it will autocomplete your fields in the schema. But yeah, there is. It's not accident that this slide is in the section of challenges, because we don't want, like, probably we don't want all of the stuff, all of the functionality of API to be exposed to the to the public. There are maybe some features that only admins should have access to. Maybe there are new feature development which we don't want to disclose yet. We want to announce in the future. Maybe it's not going to be announced at all because we're not going to release that feature, and exciting users prematurely does not seem like a great idea. And this introspection feature allows like anyone to just generate that kind of schema and like visual presentation and see what it looks like in every detail. Like the partial solution to that issue that we came up with is to just have more than one schema, like a public schema which is a subset of the full schema which is only accessible to admins and from within our infrastructure, like those authentication mechanisms that depends on whether that this call returns true or not. We expose either internal or public schema, and that like looks quite fine. It's not does not solve every problem that we have, like for new features that we don't want to expose to users yet. We still want to test them in production, maybe under some feature flag. And if we put them in internal schema, we are not going to be able to test them either. Like, it's going to be accessible from only from within our infrastructure. So yeah, that is a problem we are thinking about, possible solutions of. And I'm gonna talk about absent internals and middleware, and that's the direction we're looking into to find potential solution to that problem. Another thing is, if you've seen any real world REST API with interaction, they tend to be like a huge list of endpoints. Unless someone was very careful about upfront design. And GraphQL APIs are not insured from that possibility. They also initially had a lot of just huge list of top level fields, which were partially solved by just grouping related stuff. Kind of like it maps pretty directly from REST, that you have like some users controller, for example, and all of the queries that are related to users, all the endpoints are nested under that. And in GraphQL, we can do similarly with like the object that has basically a namespace for the related fields. That works for both mutations and queries. Here we have like for member, that exposes information about logged in user, and card exposes information about card of logged in user or anonymous user, that they also can help out. And these mutations are separate, but they can have duplicate structure from the queries. Here we have a couple of examples, like this one is only accessible to admins, but that's not exactly how it works on IAPI, but generally, yes, that structure allows us to keep it much simpler. And yeah, this is the way it's implemented in API, and it also another advantage is that we have one place to control access. Here we have like a function that returns just basically okay or an error if depending on whether there's user logged in, and if you have this member query, it doesn't make any sense for user that's not logged in to issue that query, so we're just going to return error in that case. And if you add in a new fields to the member query, you don't have to worry about authenticating every one of them, because they're going to, that authentication is going to be handled by the just by the fact that it's included in that field. So that's not just authentication. Here for the admin, we can use it to check like a group the user belongs to. In card, we can find like the identifier of the card and pass it down, because the result that this function returns gets passed to the field that's below it, and we can basically use it as a way of caching the intermediate result, which does not necessarily have to be returned to user. It's only can be used to communicate information to the fields that are below it. So one big challenge that is also present in the REST APIs is N plus one queries. Everyone who wrote any Rails is familiar with it, I assume. Mm-hmm. Right? Who's familiar with N plus one queries? Yeah.
I guess I'll explain it.
If you have a collection which you are iterating over, and for example you have like a blog with a bunch of posts, and you're iterating through the posts, and you want to find out like the number of comments that post gets. If you don't fetch everything right away, like the all the posts and all the comments, on every attempt to calculate the count of posts, it's going to make separate database requests to the comments table. So effectively you have one query to fetch all the posts and one query for every post to calculate number of comments, which is, we got N plus one. Okay. That is solved in Rails by preloading the both tables. You just add like a include key into the database query, if I remember correctly, and it issues two requests, which is better than N plus one, because N is usually more than one in that case. In GraphQL, that problem is like even bigger,
because it's easier to miss it. You can request a similar type of object from like various places in your query,
and it's going to make separate requests to the database. And at Facebook, in the initial version of GraphQL implementation that we released, had this data logger library. This one is different, this is specifically for the absent, which basically as it walks the tree that your query gets passed into, it just accumulates all of the IDs that you need to fetch. Instead of fetching them one by one, it accumulates them, and after the all of the rest of the stuff is resolved, then you calculate in the final result of the whole query that accumulated, those accumulated IDs are fetched from the database, and it's all made in one database query.
And that is a simple solution. There's a more low-level API in Absinthe called the module Absinthe middleware batch.
This is how it looks. I probably used it like a bunch of times, and even more times I reviewed the code that uses it, but every time I use it, I still have to look up in the documentation. Yeah, it's not very, it's very functional, like very, you can do whatever you want with it, but it's like hard to remember how to do it. And there's this data loader library, which looks fine if you have like a, if your GraphQL schema corresponds more or less directly to the database schema that you have, which is not the case for us. Well, database schema is way more complicated. And yes, basically to use the data loader, we would need to implement a new data loader source for each of the queries that we do. So it probably doesn't make much sense. I'm still like considering starting to use it, but
so far this API served us pretty well, and API is reasonably performant, which wasn't always the case. We like had to look for the places where it's not used and would be useful. So schema needs to like you as you implement new features, you need like new fields and need to respond to new queries. In REST API, so that's like pretty simple. You add another endpoint, and yeah, sometimes you need to change endpoints. That is much less simple. That's, you need to add like an endpoint that is a version of the endpoint that you have currently. So you need to issue like a new version of the whole API, and managing the complexity is, if you worked on any REST API that's been in production for multiple years, you probably know the pain. GraphQL solves some of those issues. You can just add stuff to your objects, to the fields. You can add new fields. Existing clients are not going to be affected by it. They are not going to receive like a bigger payload in response. They're just going to receive exact same responses that they expect. The problems start when you start to change schema in a way that's incompatible with the previous version. And you have to look. There is deprecation functionality in GraphQL specification, but yeah, it just basically adds annotation in automatically generated documentation that this field is deprecated, but it still works and everything. Sometimes what folks are developing API, we needed to make some changes that are incompatible, and we initially just deprecate the field, and if it's not instrumented, we'll maybe add some instrumentation to see if anyone is still using it. And and API is not open to the public, we just use it from our other services and applications. So we have, presumably we have control over all of the client code, so we can change it or request someone who owns that code changes it. So that's like doable for the non-public API. But still it's a lot of hassle, and it's as time goes on, we pay more and more attention to the stuff that gets added to anticipate any changes, any incompatible changes that might be required to be done in the future. Yes, GraphQL does not implement versioning. You can do it, of course, in a similar way to the REST APIs. Have multiple schemas, multiple versions of schema, and have new clients use newer versions if you must. But yeah, in general, I find that the optimal solution is to be like very careful about what you add to your API. more about the client.
What we use is Apollo client, which is a JavaScript library, which is quite sophisticated. It's not quite as opinionated as Relay, which it's very strict about all kinds of stuff. You can make Apollo work with whatever schema you got, but there are some things that you better do to make it easier. One of the things is that it has an internal storm, which is normalized. All of the JSON that you receive as responses is used to update the store, and that's what basically represents the state that is needed to render your application. Yes, in order to know which part of that store to update, everything you return needs to have an ID. Sometimes it like may be tempting to return some kind of just meaningless object or object, but for example, if you like, update some resource, some piece of information, you just might want to use like the command query separation principle and just return true or false depending on whether the operation succeeded. But Apollo client is not gonna be happy with that. You need to return the new version of the of that state so that it can update the internal state, its internal store, and in order to know which part of it is to update, it needs to have an ID associated with it. Which is like a simple rule to follow, but it's also simple to fail to follow. Also about mutations. In Rust and Grace, it's common to have a coarse grained API, which for a single post request, like a lot of stuff can be performed. We found that it's much more useful to be very specific. Like the mutation does one thing and like only that. You can have multiple mutations in one HTTP request, and they are executed in order. So if you need to do like a lot of mutations on the backend, and you don't want to, you want to avoid issuing a huge number of requests, that's like an option that you have to just use those mutations. But still, which of them, it's better if it's does some small piece of mutations. Yeah, some of the things that GraphQL allows you to do is to pass arguments to your fields. For example, if you want to do a search query, you need to pass a search string somehow, and that's what example of the thing that arguments are useful for. For mutations, it often happens that after the fact you need to update the list of arguments, and adding a new key to the object that the mutation receives is easier than adding another argument
in terms of compatibility with previous versions.
Also, mutations, as I talked about previously, should return the new, like all of the stuff that was changed by that mutation should return. And what you might want to add to that, like some other stuff about that's related to the mutation that was performed. So it's not. It's probably not a good idea to just reuse if you update some resource, like some update comment, for example, it's tempting to just return that comment from the mutation.
but it's more extensible to return an object that includes that comment and has also a place to put some metadata so that you can extend it in the future. It's one of the most frustrating parts of the Apollo client was partial results, because in GraphQL you can fetch a lot of information, a lot of data in a single HTTP request. You can request multiple fields, with multiple, like many fields nested under them, and some of those queries may fail, but it doesn't it does not stop the rest of query from being processed. And occasionally you get response that is partial. You get some data for subset of your query, and for the other subset of your query, there's just an error. And yes, previous versions of Apollo client did not like that at all. It just every time it saw an error, it just throw like user sees 500 error and nothing you can do about it. So we had to come up with our own way of representing errors, which is like does not fit very well into GraphQL specification, but that's what needs to be done in newer versions. There is like a configuration option that you can set so that it will not just throw everything away when it sees any errors. And yes, some time ago we started using GraphQL errors as they should be used, and it works quite fine. Yes, some considerations about Elixir, because most of the stuff I talked about had to do with like a specific library stuff, but we didn't yet discuss the advantages that Elixir has in terms of having a bunch of processes and having the ability to spawn processes and very easily to do concurrency. So the specification allows for the different parts of your queries to be resolved independently and concurrently. And it's like it can even be done according to specification on like different hardware. Yeah, it's quite extensible. And by default, the absence just does everything in a single process, which works surprisingly well. But sometimes you do need to have some more concurrency. And yes, but to do that, you need to spawn a new process, which has some challenges associated with it for the processing HTTP requests. Because when you process HTTP request, you probably want to have some data that is specific to that request, like maybe user ID, maybe some request ID. There's Elixir logger stores information also specific to the request. And the storage that is used for it is called process dictionary. That's some kind of online thing. That is basically a collection, associative collection that is scoped like for one process specifically. And if you spawn another process from that process, it doesn't know anything about its parent process dictionary. So you have like when you spawn a new process and you want to process part of your request in it, it's just not going to have like some metadata that you need. If you log something, the log message is going to be shown, but all of the metadata is going to be missing, and that's not very useful for debugging purposes, as you might imagine. So yeah, the solution to that we got is to not just start processes by the means provided by LLM. We have our own wrappers for every way of starting process that you need. Those wrappers basically just take a function, they capture the process dictionary of the caller process, and they, after the spawn a new process, it just insert that same process dictionary into there. So it's just propagated that way. That's like not a perfect way of solving it, because that process dictionary can be quite big, and it would be very useful if we could share it, but yeah, that's not how it works in Vim. Yeah, another iteration of that on that is to have agent, which we already talked about previously, which is basically a process that manages a piece of state. And every HTTP request that comes in can have agent spawned for it, and we can put into that agent all of the information that's needed and use the process dictionary only to store a bit of that process. So we can send a message to it, receive the piece of state that we need, and yes, that's how it works. Some more about how absent works. When request comes in, HTTP request, whether it has query or mutation, it goes through many stages of processing by absent. At the beginning, it gets parsed. After parsing, we get this tree that corresponds to the structure of the request. That tree gets validated, it gets compared to the schema, it's all like various stages of analysis done, and finally the functions that resolve the actual values get attached to that tree, and at the end the tree is walked and transformed into the response. So we draw like dozens of phases of that processing. That's like many times that tree gets traversed before getting transformed into the response. And the good thing about it is that it's every stage, every phase of processing is quite simple, and you can like read the code and understand what it does. And other thing is that you can add your own, which we have like a couple of custom stages that like maybe extract some information and put it into logger metadata, or start some process for monitoring stuff. And what's also is performed in that process is dealing with middleware, which is kind of a concept related to, like not unrelated to HTTP middleware, that you might have in some frameworks. Basically, it is like a way to have some specific functionality attached to sections of your schema tree, and there are like a bunch of built-in stuff, like not a whole bunch, but like two main things. It's like async, which allows you to asynchronously resolve the some field or object. And there's batch, the one which we saw previously. Yes. Monitoring is we found it, well, you should probably do it. Do monitoring independently of whether you're using GraphQL or not. It's just probably just a really bad practice to not monitor your application. But some things in GraphQL like would be very hard without it. One of the things we can do to make it easier is we have a wrapper for each function that resolves, part of R3, we wrap it in the resolver, which basically sends some instrumentation data before and after, like to capture the timing of request.
Plus other instrumentation. One of the things that was very useful is having a separate metric tracking for, like, for some metrics, separate tracking for the different, like for every beam instance, proved to be quite useful, because occasionally you get some misallocation of resources by Kubernetes, and the message queues in one of the beam instances grow large and latency grows, and if you just look in and at the single graph for all the application, you're not going to be able to diagnose the issue easily, because you have like most processes, like most requests are successful, but some are failing, and there is no consistent reason for them to fail. And if you look at the separate graph for each beam instance, you can see that, oh, there's one that needs to get killed. Yeah, so it's have exception monitoring, which is helpful, as you might imagine. Some errors are not as easy to diagnose as others. This one is a full stack trace of one of the errors. Good luck debugging that. This is like one of the topics that we don't do that very well yet. Distributed request tracing. We have a sort of a distributed system with multiple services that are sort of independent. And distributed request tracing is a way to get visibility into which services get invoked when user sends request. This is view that is similar to what Stefan showed with graph performance, but it, instead of like various resources that get fetched, it shows like various services that are invoked. That we can have like various controllers and then like SQL query that goes to the database instance and whatever it is next. We don't quite have that. We have like a much simpler version of doing that. What we need, like the most useful part of it, that to correlate the log entries from different services for a single request. If the user sends request, it hits some load balancer, that it hits like Nginx, then it hits our graph API, and the API sends requests to like main cache, and then it sends requests to the database, and it gets complicated very quickly. And if you don't have like any visibility into that process, you can find some errors that happened and were logged, but whether error is logged is not necessarily where it happened, right? It could have happened in a different part of our infrastructure in a different service, and it only come up at some later point. And if you have like request ID attached to it, to each request, and it's unique for every request, you can just enter it into a search bar in whatever interface you use for aggregating your logs, which you should have all for all the logs, which you should have one for all the logs from all services. And you're going to see all the log entries with the corresponding folder to that, and that makes it much easier to diagnose. That's like the most trivial benefit that you get from that sort of thing. It's, in general, it's an active area of research and many new developments over time. It changes quickly, that field, distributed request tracing. It started the study by Google, that's a Dapper paper, which you should read probably. It's not very technical and it's quite quite interesting to read about their challenges and how they solved a lot of that stuff. It's probably easier to do for Google, ironically, than for most other companies, because they have like extremely unified infrastructure. They have like one MySQL client for Java and one MySQL client for C++, and all of the requests to MySQL that they do, it happens through one of those clients. So you have to just instrument that one client, or like two versions of it, and every MySQL request is traced. So yeah, it was sort of relatively inexpensive for them to do. There is open source implementation called Zipkin. There's Jagger by Uber, which they made for their own needs and sort of open source. And open async is not like a piece of software, it's a standard, and there are some pieces of software that implement that standard. If you don't want to get into that at all, and if you use AWS, the ALB, which is their load balancer, of like a silent layer of a SAN model, which basically means that it knows about HTTP. It can insert this header, it's Amazon request ID, and if it sees a request that has that header, it just appends another header to it, which basically allows you to reconstruct that sort of tree, maybe without all of the timestamps. But yeah, this kind of interface is potentially very useful. You can see all of the dependencies that are required for processing a request, and they're all like nicely topologically sorted, and you can see like which take more time, and it's very quickly, you can very quickly discover the opportunities for optimization, or maybe some of those services are not needed at all to process this specific kind of request. So yeah, it gives you much better visibility than just reading code over like dozen code bases. We have like a somewhat interesting situation with data stores, in that we use Aurora cluster on AWS, which has like a one master and bunch of read-only replicas, and we want as many as possible of the read-only requests to go to replicas, and all of the requests like SQL queries that make any mutations that they obviously have to go to master, because that's the only one that's writable. And some of the read requests have to go to that too, because of the latency between when the change gets to master and when it gets replicated. It's often a couple of seconds, which not always acceptable. So we have two data stores, which effectively two data stores, as far as Acto is concerned, like two different wrappers. One is for read-only requests and the other is for writing, which makes it difficult to do transactional tests, because every single request, to like a GraphQL request, can trigger multiple changes to multiple data stores. And if that change is made in transaction, it's going to be isolated from the different requests. So yes, we have to just what we end up doing is just clearing database after every test. We're like not doing it quite as quite, it's not quite as bad as that. We just clear all the tables that were affected, but still, it makes it impossible for us to use the asynchronous testing.
Yeah.
At least as far as database tests are concerned. Also, something that we found very useful with
as time goes by is GraphQL tests, which is basically we construct the query as a string and we pass it to the library directly to the absent, and it processes all of that stuff and returns you back like a result. And that is useful mostly for like documentation purposes. If you see some field you don't know what it's doing, you can look into tests and see how it works, what's the intended usage of it, and what are the failure conditions, and that sort of stuff. We don't have a GraphQL test for every GraphQL field that we got in our schema, but for the stuff that was developed recently, we do try to maintain a pretty solid coverage. Yeah, they know those tests don't run quite as fast as you prefer, but still quite useful. As you might have heard during the next talk, as was announced on the SQL view, property testing is coming, and we already got some property tests that are not very useful yet, but we are looking forward to doing more of that. So to summarize our journey of implementing GraphQL in Elixir, it's not without challenges, but we are pretty happy with the language and with the libraries that we got. It's not everything is as stable as we would prefer it to be. Obviously, as is not surprising for the new language as Elixir. We have like more troubles with libraries that you prefer also, but yeah, we had to make significant changes to the MySQL library, for example, to make it work with Sphinx. Yeah, Sphinx can pretend to be MySQL. We didn't know that. And yes, most of the developers that are working on our Elixir application were not familiar with Elixir before they started doing that. Most were not even familiar with functional programming, but it worked out quite well. Even some of the more junior people in American office ended up learning Elixir quite fast and very productive in it. Yeah, probably if we had some statically typed functional language, it would be much harder for people to become productive in. Yes, and as I said, it's not without difficulties. The most challenges that we had came from OTP. It's not like a fault of OTP, it's just that you have to get used to it. To this model that supervision and the supervision piece and processes that get restarted, and some failure conditions are pretty hard to make work with the supervision piece. And that's mostly like also our fault, because like the way we used to think about failures, which is not very compatible with like language file philosophy. As also GraphQL tooling is getting much better and development experience is improving, it's getting more popular in general, so yes. It has significant potential in the future, I think. If you want to hear more about Teachers Pay Teachers and infrastructure and
usage of Elixir. My teammate Shanti gave a number of talks at various conferences. Those are like titles and links to them. And yes, her talks have advantage of containing a bunch of funny pictures, which mine doesn't. Yeah, that would be it. I work at Vice Engineering on the Teachers Pay Teachers. We are hiring, obviously, and thanks for your attention. Depends on the kind of error. That can be handled very differently. I'm not too familiar with the client-side application, but for most, like for a lot of cases, when, for example, something fails, you can either return an error on the server side or return like a null for that field that was requested. In most cases, we return an errors, and the Apollo client used to not like them, but newer versions can build quite fine. It's just a conditional on the client that says show an error pop up or something like that, like show an error message.
I mean, how do you handle it on a GraphQL API level?
Oh, GraphQL API level. The solver, like the function that gets some data associated with the field that was requested, it has to return a tuple, which its first element either okay if it was successful, or error if it wasn't. And you can attach error message, and if it was successful, you attach some data. In this case, the data is empty because all that we need from this function is to let it invoke the resolvers that are underneath it. Because it gets passed to the resolvers underneath, and in this case, there's no information to pass. I don't know, does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay, anyone else?
Thank you. And I don't need microphone. So anyway, we're having 5-minute break and then the next talk starts.